And I happened to used to start singing on the Fat Down the Ferry Boat through the Uncle Jesse, because Jesse was the one that really started the 4SOGs.
That would be Jesse Daniels?
Yes, Jesse Daniels. And we used to sit out there with the hat, do imitations of Michael Jackson, James Brown, Elvis Presley, stuff like that, you know what I'm saying? But I came in like in that world a little bit later because my entrepreneur, you know, at the time, the group that I sang with was called the Cook Corporation. And I was 16 and 17 years old. That's how I learned the harmonies and stuff like that that I do. And that's how I got taught, because we sang a cappella all the time. And then, you know, we all, you know, cahoots, you know, with that. Because we had did a, they had a talent show every year at Martin Luther King Junior High School, whatever they called it, right? The first year, we took first prize, Cook Corporation. The second year, that's when Steve and TC and all of them, and they went and did it. And then they won first prize. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
But we all knew each other from Staten Island. I was singing with the Cook Corporation. They was doing the LDs, you know, they thing.
Right.
But we was all friends. So there came a time to we was always singing together. And I was showing them little certain harmonies and how, you know, to do this stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's when they was really digging it. So then after that, we started doing like little shows like in Paterson, New Jersey, because Steve and them was called themselves the Force MCs. And that's when me, Jesse, and TC started getting together. And they was doing little rhymes before, but they didn't have little, like, real harmonies to them. When we all got together, we started doing the harmonizing with the, you know, with you know, all the little rhymes that they was doing and stuff.
So this was like one of the birthings of a meshing of hip-hop and R&B.
Right. That's the birth of how it really happened.
Okay.
That's how it happened. And then, just from us being together so much, that's when it groomed from being in the streets in New York with that hat down. Our show and our routine was already prepared because we knew how to judge the audience. If you do that, then they don't like it. And then, okay, do that. And then if they like that, you keep this in. Nah, take that out, because, you know, they ain't feeling that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Then after that, then Mr. Magic, you know, came around because he would be at the Harlem World and all them clubs back then, you know what I'm saying? We'd be performing, you know, LL. Nobody had no labels yet. You understand what I'm trying to say?
Right.
Because we was running around with Mr. Magic from WBLS. Mm-hmm. Anybody had no record deals and all some crazy shit.
Right.
But we knew people like Curtis Blow and stuff like that. So, you know, we were always Grandmaster Flash. Melly Mel, that's like my right hand man. He comes to all my birthday parties and stuff. You know, so it was like, you know, it was destined to happen. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So Steve and them like met, you know, Mr. Magic, and a lot of times he used to come get us, but we'd be on Staten Island, we'd meet him on Manhattan side, and then we'd go to the club with Mr. Magic, when he was the DJ for WBLS. You understand what I'm saying? Then he wanted to introduce us to Tommy Boy. So we went to Tommy Boy Records, and we auditioned right in Tommy Boy's face. This before Tommy had all them computers and stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, he had his little thing in his basement, you know, at his home.
Right.
And we auditioned there. Then we signed with Tommy Boy Records. Then after that, about a year later, he got a thing on First Avenue. Tommy Boy Records is at. We came home from tour. Got all the computers there now. You know, you got all, you know, all that stuff is in their office now. But they had African Bambaataa, Full Phonics Source was signed, the Justin Crew, a couple other, you know, people that were signed to the label. But, you know, Force and Bees. That's when we came out with Let Me Love You. And Tears was the second single. Which, you know, we all wrote Let Me Love You, then Tears and Me and TC wrote that one. Then now all the computers is in the office and all that stuff. You know what I'm saying? They treated us good and fairly well. Then after that, it was just like, you know, normal getting paid, getting you know, tours and getting little royalties, you know what I'm saying? But we didn't get a lot of royalties because it takes time. Because they got to recoup their money first, you know what I'm saying? That's why we didn't do a video on Let Me Love You or Tears. Because, you know, but when Forgive Me Girl came out, we shot that in London. They must have accumulated money as far as the business is concerned. You feel what I'm trying to say?
Right.
It was still low budget because we was going over there actually promoting the stuff overseas that we're doing. So the label overseas comforted that bill and stuff like that if we get out there and shoot it. That's why that video, if you really notice it, it's not like a major video. But back then in the 80s, wasn't nothing, this was all brand new to the game. It ain't like what it is now. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, years and years go past and everything gets better. You know what I'm saying? Before, we didn't even have cell phones. You know what I'm saying? You probably had a beeper.
Right.
And that's the only thing you had. You walk down the street right now, you don't even see a payphone no more. You feel me?
Right.
That's the difference. So the game changed, but the people still stay the same. That's the way I look at it. You know what I'm saying? I'm still going to be Trisco. You know what I'm saying? If the game changed, let's change that game with the game.
Right.
But when it comes down to it, you know, that's just history of how this business is going and, you know, what it's about. Personally, that's how, you know, I really feel. You know what I mean? from, you know, when we came out, it was like, you know, we went to different countries, you know, different cities and stuff like that. And they didn't even speak our language, but they knew the words to our song. You know, we was out there Rotterdam and Holland, places like that, Japan, and stuff like that. At least, you know, when we, you know, came out and got promoted that far, that just to show you that that's how people follow music from, you know, the United States, as far as I'm concerned. And they can sing the words, but they probably don't understand the words, but they can sing it. So that inspired everybody, you know, that inspired me and a lot of other artists that's in the game, that, you know, travel. Music is a universal thing.
Right.
Language. Situation, you understand? So it's like about more movement or chorus or words that's getting you up or getting you hype or something like that. because that's more dance feel. Rap, to me, is more like seriousness as far as situations are concerned, as far as the economy is concerned, or as how people grew up, or as how people lived. You understand? It's more poetic to me. That's why rap is so strong, because rappers, they saying a message. To whereas when it's hip hop, it's just about the dance, the graffiti, party, da 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 da. Get it?
Tonight, the world cried. That was then. This is now. The new, the Trisco Show. Asking everyone to stand up at this time and help us shake the room.
Get up, y'all! Get up! Everybody get up! We're not playing with you. We're going to the Trisco Show. So wake up here.
FMD for life.
Right.
You know, that's what I own. You feel me? what I'm doing, I'm just doing the Trisco Show to bring out artists that didn't make it, or artists that want to make it. That's why a lot of material that I'm doing right now, I'm always featuring a featured artist, whether they're known or unknown. See, the unknown is the ones. I call this the misfit move. You know, it's the people that don't get the records that's better or sound better or got that heart in them. You understand what I'm saying? That drive to be able to make it. So if I could reach back and bring something to the table that everybody can understand, that these are true artists. Nobody's faking the funk, or nobody's doing nothing other than just being themselves as an artist. That's what I respect more than to where I hear a lot of stuff that where it sounds kind of like a fake.
Right.
You know, that's what the Trisco Show consists of. It's realness. You understand? People that lives it. People that breathe it. You understand what I'm saying? We'll be right back.